Hey guys, Norwegian Gamer, and playing some Hearts of Iron 3, their finest hour. I'm playing this because my mega campaign is going to take forever to get here, and I just want to show you this perfect game before Hearts of Iron 4 comes out. So, I go first, talk. Of the game itself, it's got a lot of advanced combat, as you will see when you play the scenarios, which is just combat related. And it doesn't have to be it doesn't need to be historical, like Operation Unthinkable, where Soviet attacked the Allies 1st of January 1946. But, and then, we had the save games, of course. I have one save game. I had more, but, I downloaded the mod, which was not finished, and it asked me to make a backup of the game, because it will change some files or delete some files, I should say. But then back up my save games because they are not located in the same file when you have the Steam. But it did well as China. Well, of course, the Japanese have taken this area. But I have taken this area here. You know? Then you have the historical starts. It's real. You just start as someone and you continue from there. And also, there's various. Show to that later, but then you have the custom starts. You might see that some has like some of the starts have disappeared. Guess because this makes countries like nationalist China, probably even like other nations really easy to play as. The way to choose how your country start out. Somewhat. You can choose like your neutrality or how close you are to faction, or if you are a faction member. You can choose whatever tech you start with. And you can also choose what troops you start with. And of course, convoys and escort stuff. Going to historical start, since that will show like kind of how, I don't know if that's how it was during that game. But we gonna play as USA for this time. It is probably the most easiest country to play as. If you think about major factions. See little fighting in longer time. Of course, the Japanese are also really easy. You don't really get in the melee fights, you know. Soviet Union's not going to push them. Just to say, they have to be afraid of. They're also going to be able to invade another kingdom from Siam. Okay, but let's jump in. Okay, so political map mode is what? Map was terrain, simplified terrain map mode. You have the weather map mode. Because the weather actually does something in this game. I have no idea what it does. It temperature minus 10.4 degrees Celsius. Pressure wind speed. Yeah, you see, it's really complicated. Intel map mode. Full Intel. I never actually used this. I probably should use that more. Default risk map mode. Diplomatic map mode. You can see your enemies on your course. Region map mode. Supply map mode. Supplies are really important in this game. As if a unit don't get supplied, they are going to have a really problem trying to. Yeah, they can't really do anything, they can't move. And they will easily be taken out by enemies. And then we have the infrastructure map mode. There's 100%, and if you go to supplies, with 10 out of 10 infrastructure and current technology, we can transport 800 supplies and fuel per day. Supplies from Washington DC, 4 nodes away. Local supply 2.72, local fuel 0. Required daily supply 2.72, fuel 0. Received supply, so on and so on. Then you have the VP map mode. In the end, if there is this three factions, and you get points for VPs. More VPs you control, the more points. And you can see there's a lot. I think if we go to the ledger, we can see who has the most VP, and it's Soviet Union and France. United Kingdom and Germany. So that's a lot of VP points for Germany when they take France. We also have the theater map mode. We chose the theater we have. So we have three theaters right now. We have the Connors East Theater and the Connors West Theater and the Pacific Theater. We have the air map mode showing air bases. With the planes in. I don't really know what this circle means. I don't know the operation range for tactical bomber and interceptor. Check that out. Operation range. I guess it's the range for them. Interceptor. Bomber? Yeah, maybe. Then we have the naval map mode. Show off some routes you might see. That is supply and trade routes. We go more into that later. With the strength map mode. Just shows us where we have good amount of troops, I guess. I'm not really. Then resources map mode. So if you go to like Houston, we can see that it produced energy 3 out of 3, rare materials and crude oil. And we have a lot of resources. Let's go back to diplomatic mode, map mode. Let's have a look. So if we start with resources, we have energy, metal, rare materials and oil, crude oil. Energy is, as it says, energy production covers various sources of energy, but it's mainly coal. Energy is required to produce IC. Heavy industry requires various metal ores, although this is primarily iron ore. These are used to produce IC. Rare materials cover a spectrum of materials essential for war production, including natural products like rubber and less common metals like chromium. These are essential for the production of IC. crude oil is essential for any modern army to operate. However, it must first be refined into usable products. So if you look at these ones, you see that this sphere here is used for IC. And this is then we have supplies. Supplies cover everything a modern army needs to fight except POL. Although perhaps most important of all is ammunition. Supplies are produced by IC. We'll see that later. Oh, I guess this is POL. Petroleum, oil and lubricants. Refined from crude oil, all motorized units, aircraft and ships need these to operate effectively. Then we have money. Money especially consists of reserves of gold and foreign exchange, and is used to purchase resources from other countries that are not produced at home. Money is produced by a nation's industrial capacity. So USA, you will not have any problems with resources. But if you're playing as China, you probably have almost no resources at all. And I know that because I play as them. Then we have manpower. So manpower is what you need to build units, planes, boats, fleets and so, navies and so on. That's a monthly gain, it's just quite low for us. And from improved technology, 4%, volunteer army, -50%, new deal, -4%. So you're not going to have much manpower. Then we have diplomatic influence, which is used for when you go into, just, you need to do it like a lot of that. This is one influence point. Non-aggression pact uses 5, and so on and so on. And when you're a faction leader, later you can influence a nation to your faction. And that goes to... where you see that later, actually. Espionage, the summon spies you have, which you can send, which you have in your home country to do stuff or send to perhaps Germany. We have the officer ratio, which is max 140%, and it's really bad if it gets lower than it. So it's important to keep that up, and when it produces new units, that's going to go down. We have dissent, which the short-term unhappiness of our people. This can be reduced by increasing the supply of consumer goods to the civilian economy. If ignored, this will start to diminish support for the ruling parties, and you also lose some IC. Not much though. Then we have National Unity. That takes a long time to get up. Currently nothing, yeah. National Unity represents the willingness of the people at the top to prosecute a war to the finish. The higher this value is, the longer you fight on before considering surrender and a government in exile. And a government in exile means that you surrendered. If you're in a faction and another faction attacks you and you surrender, you will lose all of, you will become a government in exile. You will not lose all of your land, as Netherlands will keep their colonies over here, Belgium will keep the colony over here, France will keep some land over here. They will lose this though, this part of Northern Africa. And of course we have the date, time, we have our national modifiers, I guess, neutrality, espionage bonus plus 10%, counter espionage plus 10%, research efficiency -5%, grand fleet leadership plus 0.15, organization region rate plus 15%. Then we also have a new deal, national manpower modifier, -4%, and consumer goods during peacetime, plus 25%. Now, let's go into diplomacy. So, here you see the three factions, you have the Axis, Allies, and Comintern. Here is all of the nations which are drifting towards one of the factions, which you can influence, which leaders can influence, or then nations can choose themselves by aligning towards the faction. We are... Let's just click on our country like this. We are over here. We have no need to do anything. You can also see what resources they have, if they are losing resources. Just good, because they're probably paying more, I guess. We're just going to set the ultimate trade. Here's also your decisions. I can stab it in the back. Italy is at war with the United Kingdom. Unlimited national emergency, and yeah. The day of infamy, USA is at war. Gain 6 unity, lose negative 50 neutrality. Gain 500 manpower, and national manpower modifier. Gearing up for war. One of Germany is at war with the United Kingdom. At war. Then we lose this new deal, which is bad. Which is bad for our country right now. You can see that we are a democratic party. Our current relations with ourselves is 85. Our threat towards them is... Our threat to ourselves is 0. Their threat towards me... 0, their neutrality is 100%, our neutrality is 100%, highest threat, Germany at 0. Threats can be added in intelligence with, by making a more threat than you are. So, because you have a thing called neutrality and threat. To be able for me to declare war on, for example, Canada, our neutrality. We cannot declare war because our neutrality is higher than the present threat. Our neutrality is currently 100, and the effective threat between us and Canada allows us to declare war when our neutrality is at 0. Threats can be added if you conquer nations, like when Germany is going to conquer Poland and Denmark, they're going to get a higher threat with France, and the farther they are, less threat. Threat. When Soviet Union annexed Latvia, Estonia and Lithuania, they get more threat. If someone sends spies to increase the threat, of course they get more threat. Now we can go to production. So the game always starts with probably someone producing. And people, here's the theaters what they need. What they want. So if you click, I will just build there. It's a build. This is actually the first time they want a light armor brigade. They're going to ask for more, a lot more, and we're going to give it to them. You can also see what the energy metal rim, what resources you get. So we're getting negative something, that's going to get better. You can see your IC here. You can click it on manual control. We're going to prioritize reinforcements. Upgrades, actually. And also this lend list. You can send IC to other nations when you're close enough and you're to the faction and your neutrality is low enough. Or you can receive. Send or receive. It's good for the small nations to get some more IC. Like Canada, you can choose to get some IC from USA and the United Kingdom. And you're not really going to be able to build much with this little manpower. So I usually have this on prioritizing, because I don't need to check this every time. And you have divisions where you can build up like this. It's not really that effective. Yeah, and little infantry consolidator, infantry paratroopers. You can attach just add one brigade at a time and not add them in division if you have a division you want to reinforce. If you have rings, you can get planes, flotilla, airbase, naval bases, you can build more, I see. You can build anti-air guns, you can build radar stations, you can build nuclear reactors, rocket test sites. I don't know if it makes sense to have more or less of one or more. But you get that later. Convoys, escorts. We're just going to start building some convoys, shall we? There we go. Now we're building 1,000 extra convoys. And you might know why you're doing that. Like, they'll show you some ICE on. Could build more ICE, but I'm going to have so much ICE. I can build ICE forever. And I'm going to lose a lot of convoys. As Germany send their submarines, Japs send their submarines, and you know. Escort's not going to really help that. You can see your convoys. And then there's the trade routes. This is an auto create, so yeah, that's the easiest. Then we can go to technology. There you have this distribution of leadership. We get the officers to get more higher officer rate, diplomacy to get more diplomatic influence, espionage to get more spies, and research to research more. The number that says here is the number you can research. First off, we're going to get this done. Oh, fucking crazy. Put that one for now. Diplomacy. We are good. We don't need any. Espionage. Start at like 3.8. We'll see. And then research is when you right click this, it will lock it. And then, wait, actually, do that. There. And every extra point you get in will come here. And then here you can do set it all on AI control, so it research and distribution of leadership, research AI, or slider AI. You're going to put on research AI. First things first, upgrade militia. You might think, like, why are you doing that? Are you going to use militia in the army? No. I'm not. It's just, I'm going to have a lot of militia. Garrisons are really good at holding. Then we're going to upgrade our infantry. Get engineers. We're gonna try and get some marines now. Mountaineers. Motorized mechanized. I need to get this up as well. Yeah, get some motorized infantry. Armor. Go up, get some light stuff. I don't really use armored cars. Get artillery at least and anti tank. To be inefficient though. Rocket test there, get that later. Nuclear. Hey, if it's here, we can get the nuclear bomb. We can also get a flying bomb. Oh, that's the most. Yeah, I love that. Hope you get some air. You know. Maybe some bombers. I don't know. I get some land though. Going to see if we can upgrade our garrisons. Morale. People's army. That's good. Can get some more ambush. I don't really need ambush. I'm going to get Spirit Doctrine. Make a nice offensive. Mass Assault. Get a grand battle plan, it's always good. Infantry warfare. Delay doctrine. Yeah, then we'll get to that later. I don't really know what I should do. I probably upgrade my submarines and destroyers, I don't know. Technology, yeah, I don't know what's the best thing to research about. Just research what I think find best. Then we go to politics. You can see that our leading party is social liberal. Your democratic party. Okay, we can choose the foreign minister. Guess ruling party support. Supplies, always a good thing to have. Counter espionage. Counter intelligence. I don't know what's about. Let's get some political intel. Organization regenerate. Armor. Capital ships. And then we get to this later. We can get specialist training. Okay, that's. And we also have this strategic warfare, impacting convoys. This will impact our national unity, which will impact how, if you're going to surrender or not. Like attack convoys, if the enemies attack our convoys, we lose. Or if we manage to defend our convoys against attacks or kill convoy hunters. It's also fighting in our homelands or allied brigades. In combat, bombing in our lands or our bombing, or if we engage these enemy bombers, then we have intelligence. We're going to put that up. Counter espionage on fern. Wait, no. No, there's. I think that was what. That's the best, but we're going to go to major, so we're going to Germany. We're going to need some of your tech. Oh, that was the wrong one. And now what's the best about tech, or what should you do? We just like tech. You can also see what you got. It's one spy. And you have one spy, you don't know if it's that for sure. That seems like a little. And then your theaters, it will tell us about how they'll do in this, how they'll do. We will have no problems defending this position. And they have all of these different stances. You have forces in that theater. Immediate needs. Now let's go to more let's go into here and click in T to edit the theater, and then just going to click and drag. let's find the search quarters and delete it. Then we're also going to add this. If I don't know what I'm doing, it's I don't like controlling my I don't like controlling air units, not naval units. I'm just sorry. I'm going to call this US Home Command. This is the US Fleet Command. I'm also going to attach that to US Home Command, AI Control. Attach you to Fleet Command. It's Fleet Command. Oh wait, no, fuck. I'm going to attach them, this guy's to Pacific Theater. She's also going to Air Control. Like that, and clicking A or this button to attach. Then I'm clicking the other. Can I touch this one? See. Then clicking D to detach them. They should be attached to specific features, shouldn't they? Set of ships. Okay, and this one we're going to attach to the fleet command. No. Fucked up. There we go. Fleet command. Fleet command. Atlantic transports. Pacific transports. Then we have the bombers. Attach them to the Air Force. Like there and there. And we also get rid of a lot of ships like that, you know. I think we are done then, right? And it's so we have the battle planner, create historical or current plans. You have show behind current battle plans. You have victory conditions, which we have seen. And we have strategic effects, which you can see someone is here. The great air force, total. Planes at least 75. Great army, number of brigades at least 800. Veteran army, land battle SWAT at least 250. You know, this good shit. And find province, but now we go to max speed. Is it? There we go. You want 33 garrisons, 8 infantry, 1 interceptor, and 1 tactical bomber. We're going to build that. And we're also going to end this episode. Wow. Yeah, I used up a lot of my manpower, but it's fine. But I guess we'll see you guys next time. Have a great time.